Moisture meter or finger? Top watering versus bottom watering? To mist or not to mist? Grow lights versus natural light? Tissue culture tetrasperma or regular tetrasperma? Do I want to say this? Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel, or welcome to my channel if this is the first time you're seeing me. My name is Becca and this is my YouTube channel where I talk about a lot of houseplant stuff. And today I'm going to be talking about some pretty popular planty debates, and I thought it would be fun just to sit down and tell you what I think about all of these things. I'm very inspired by Jenna Marble's idea where it's kind of like, don't get me started, I think that's what she calls it. So I'm going to be doing sort of a video like that where I tell you my opinion on certain things and debates within the plant community and beyond. So let's just get right into it. I asked you guys to give me some topics to discuss in my Instagram stories. So if you're not following me on Instagram, that's a really great way to make sure that you're informed about what videos I'm filming and what I'm up to on YouTube, because I share a lot of what I'm doing over there on Instagram. My at name is De La Plants, very easy to find. All right, so the first one is Hoyas in terracotta pots or ceramic pots. So the reason that this is a debate is because a lot of people say that Hoyas will embed their roots into the porous holes of the clay in terracotta. And I believe that that is definitely true, but the thing is, I have a lot of my Hoyas in terracotta, even though that is a thing. And the reason is not because I'm a rebel, but because I know that if I was to soak the terracotta before I repotted the plant, the roots would be loosened from the clay. So I really don't have an issue with that. On that debate, I would say Hoyas are okay in terracotta. And mostly that's because I just prefer terracotta, but we will get to that in the future. Okay, the next one is pothos versus pathos. Pathos? Pothos? There's a lot of different ways to say the word pothos, but I definitely say pothos instead of pathos. Okay, there was a lot that said to mist or not to mist. And I used to be a big mister. I was really, really, really keen on misting. And I think that's because in my early plant journey, I really wanted to like baby my plants and give them as much love as possible. And so someone actually commented on my video I posted yesterday that if you have a tendency to like helicopter parent your plants, misting is a nice outlet, and also brushing off your plants, like dusting them with like makeup brushes and stuff like that, is like a really great way to satiate that feeling of needing to parent your plants. And so on that note, I would say that I'm not a mister anymore, just because I noticed that when I was really big into misting, my plants would get dust on them a lot faster. And I'm not exactly sure why that is, but I used to mist my rubber tree a lot just to raise the humidity. And I've just heard a lot of research that misting doesn't actually do much to increase the humidity long term. Like maybe it does for a few minutes, but other than that, it doesn't really do much. So I would say I'm in the group that is not misting. Okay, the next one is to repot in the winter time or to not repot in the winter time. And I think that this really, really depends on where you live. I know that a lot of people who live in places where it's a no-no to do that still have had success and no issues. I think that if your plant is clearly in distress, I think that it's totally fine to break open the pot and see what's going on, or if you get a new plant. I would say that I still repot my plants in the winter time because where I live, it's usually so warm, like I'd say 10 months out of the year, so I don't really have issues with my plants going completely dormant. There's another debate that is propagating in the winter or not propagating in the winter, and I still propagate in the winter and I still get roots. I don't have any issues. Maybe it might take a little bit longer for them to get established because they're not in like the peak growing season. I don't know, I have never had any issues with that. The next one I think is very interesting, and it says local nurseries versus big box stores. I would say it just depends on where you are financially and where you are in your plant journey, because where I am currently, I would probably say nurseries, because big box stores really don't have the things that I'm looking for right now. But if I did need something like a basic plant, I know that I could go to a big box store like Lowe's or Home Depot and grab those plants. But the thing is, sometimes those plants can be unhealthy or just kind of be going downhill by the time that you get them. I don't know. I think that I would definitely prefer a local nursery, just because I like to support local businesses before a corporation. And so with local nurseries usually being like family owned and operated, I would usually prefer that, just because also the quality is usually a lot better and the people are a lot more knowledgeable about plants. So you get the knowledge and you get some quality plants with that. And then the next one that's sort of related to that is ordering online or buying plants in person. And I would say that I much, much prefer buying plants in person. And that is because I'm looking at the plant, I'm seeing the quality that it is in, there's not going to be any stress from shipping. I think that ordering plants online can create a lot of waste. And I've noticed that specifically with like buying things on Amazon. I know that's not like plants, but online orders just create so much waste, and I've been so overwhelmed with boxes and packaging materials lately because I have been ordering a lot online a lot, and I've just come to terms with the fact that it's so much waste. It was really crazy being confronted with how much waste I was creating. And so with that being said, I am definitely making an initiative in 2020 to order online less. Okay, another question that I got a ton of is top watering versus bottom watering. And I'm going to admit something. I hate bottom watering. I hate it so much. It is, to me, it's just like so much harder to gauge how much water the plant has gotten. And there are a few plants that I have bottom watered in the past, like my Fittonias and my African violets. I've always bottom watered African violets, but that's just because I was so scared that I would get water on the leaves and burn them. The thing is with bottom watering is it just takes so much longer. And also if you only bottom water, you're not really giving the plant an opportunity to flush out all of the extra minerals and things that are living in the soil. Well, not living, but just like chilling in the soil. I much prefer to top water so that I can see the water coming out the bottom. And just with also the quality of water where I live, I water 90% of my plants with tap water. I know that there could be a lot of buildup if I only bottom watered. So I guess if you enjoy bottom watering, make sure that you top water every once in a while so that the plant can kind of flush out all of those things. The next one is rare plants versus common plants. This is difficult, but I'm going to have to say common plants. And it feels kind of ironic because I have sort of gotten a nice group of quote unquote rare plants. And I think that the term really should be hard to find plants because, I don't know, the phrase rare plants just kind of, I'm just a little bit iffy on it. And I know what we mean when we say it because I have said it myself and I continue to say it myself. But I think that I want to start saying hard to find plants in the future. I don't know. But anyway, I would say that I prefer common plants just because they're so easy. And well, usually they're so easy and they're easy to find. And if you mess up, you can get another one. And I don't know, typically I think that they're just as beautiful as the rare plants. The rare plants is kind of like the thrill of the chase, and I love that part of it, but there's just something so satisfying about looking over and seeing like my Monstera deliciosa green version, and it's thriving and it's so happy. There's just something so sweet about that. Like, I'm never stressed about my common plants ever, but I think every single day I'm like sweating about my rare or hard to find expensive plants because I don't want to kill them. I don't want something to happen to them because that would really, really suck. I do feel confident in my abilities to take care of them, but just knowing like how special they are kind of puts a lot of pressure on myself. And so I think like there's maybe like one or two rare plants that I'm searching for still, but after that, I mean, I really don't think that there's anything else I would want, anything else that I could really handle, to be honest, because I'm not a person who likes to spend a ton of time tending to my plants, which might seem weird considering I have a lot of plants and I have a houseplant channel, but houseplants are not my entire life. I have so many other things going on, and I just don't have time for all of that. So in the debate, I would say common plants just because they're so much easier. Pots with drainage or pots without drainage? I would say that I don't have a single plant in a non-draining pot. That's really my answer. I would never pot a plant without drainage just because, as I said before, with top watering, it's really important for me that my plants kind of have a flush every couple of weeks. So I would never put a plant in a non-draining pot. I do have a plant in a, like, it's actually a creamer holder, but the mouth spout, like you can pour water out of the mouth spout, if that makes any sense at all. And so there is drainage in a sense, but it's not traditional drainage. But would I ever put like my tetrasperma in a non-draining pot? Never, ever. All right, next one. To aerate or not to aerate? And I actually made a post about aerating the soil on one of my plants, and I got a lot of kickback on it, which was very shocking to me. Some people were saying that I was doing it wrong, and some people were saying that aerating the soil disturbs the natural makeup that the soil has made for itself. I don't really know exactly what it was, but I will say that I do aerate my plants when I have the chance, because with the quality of my water, it kind of makes the soil dry into like a cement block, and if I haven't watered a plant in a long time, the water just runs right off the edges of the soil. Soil is like a sponge, so when your sponge dries out completely, it takes a while for the water to absorb. And I'm not here trying to waste gallons upon gallons of water to get into that sponge, so the way that I get into the sponge is by aerating my soil. And I just take like a crochet or knitting needle and I just kind of scrape across the top and I like poke little holes, and that helps so much. And if I poke a root, it's not a big deal. I've never had a plant die because I aerated. I've never had a plant suffer in any way. Next one is propagating in water, sphagnum moss, or LECA beads or LECA balls. And I would say that I'm a huge proponent for water propagation. Water is just so much more readily available, and it's so much easier to monitor the progress of the plants. Like, I would say I have propagated every single plant I've ever propagated in water, and half my collection started from propagations. So, I don't know, I've just had a lot of good luck with it. So I will always use that as my go-to. I will always use water as my acclimation tool because it works. Soil or LECA? This is hard because all of my plants are currently in soil, but I think honestly, I would probably do better with LECA just because it basically eliminates like fungus gnats and a lot of other issues with pests. It's also a lot more passive as far as taking care of them goes, I've heard. I just have so many plants, and transitioning all of them to LECA would maybe be expensive and take a lot of time. I also wonder how that would go if you ever had to move your plants and all of them were in hydro or like semi-hydro. I don't know, if you have plants in semi-hydro and you've ever moved, leave a comment down below and tell me how that went, because I'm very interested to see, I don't know, and to hear what that's like, because I do have a few plants that I would like to try in semi-hydro. Okay, next one, grow lights versus natural light. I would say natural light, 100%. I have some grow lights set up in my house, or I did have some grow lights set up in my house in my kitchen, and I just noticed that the soil just stays moist for so much longer, even though they're getting a lot of sun, quote unquote. I don't know, it's very odd. I mean, maybe because they're not getting warmer. A lot of my plants sit in the windowsill, and those plants just dry out so much faster, even if it is the winter time. And I think it really has a lot to do with like just the sun and the heat just drying out the soil. So I've thought about maybe putting like heating pads underneath my plants that are on grow lights. Like I said, I experienced a lot of issues with my plants staying too moist for too long, even if it was in the same soil mixture as my plants on the windowsill. So I much prefer natural light, obviously. There are some cases when a grow light is helpful, but I just usually, I'd prefer not to use grow lights if I don't have to. Okay, the next one is water a little bit more often or water thoroughly less often. And I would say water thoroughly less often. Anytime I water my plants, I put them in the sink or in the bathtub, no matter what plant it is. I mean, besides the ones outside where they can just drain freely, because I much prefer to just completely soak and saturate my plants, because that is usually what is in their natural environment, especially my desert plants, because it only rains a couple times a year here, and when it does, it's like so. This is a big question that a lot of people asked, which is ceramic pots or terracotta, and do the beautiful designs on ceramic pots outweigh the fact that they can't wick out? I am 100% a terracotta person, or just clay pots in general, because it works really well to wick out the extra moisture, and also it's just, I don't know, it's just so much better in my opinion. I'm such a terracotta fan, or just clay pots in general. I do have some clay pots that are unglazed on the inside and only half glazed on the outside, if that makes any sense, or they're like half glazed, so that there is still some element that is wicking away moisture. Ceramic pots, I think that it just locks in moisture a lot longer, and I prefer to not do that. I definitely err on the side of like letting my plants dry out a lot, like to the point where they look maybe a little bit sad, and then I water them, especially in the winter time. I never want to overwater a plant in the winter. So yeah, that's That's my opinion on that. I'm a terracotta girl all the way. Okay, next one is variegated plants versus classic plants. I think that it really depends on the plant specifically, but I would say that the classic plant is a lot easier to take care of and there's a lot less stress involved because there's only a few plants out there that have consistent and stable variegation, like the Thai constellation. I don't have to worry about my Thai constellation losing its variegation at any point because it's consistent. Things like Albo Monstera or Albo Arrowhead is inconsistent variegation. Those plants can lose their variegation if they're not getting what they need. And so that seems very stressful to me. And although I do have a lot of variegated plants, the non-variegated is less stressful. They're not as beautiful most of the time, but they're just so much more consistent and easy to take care of. All right, next one is daytime watering versus nighttime watering. A lot of people say that you shouldn't water your plants at night. For me, I have always watered at really any hour of the day and I've never had any issues, but I've heard that if you water in the morning it gives the plant all day to kind of absorb and then evaporate the rest of the water or something like that. I've watered late at night because that's when I had time to do it and I've never had any issues doing that. Okay, the next one is to leave yellow leaves or to cut them off. I usually leave yellow leaves until they are 100% yellow and then after that I'll pull them off. Usually until the plant kind of lets that leaf go, I'll leave it there. And when I say that, I mean when the plant kind of, when it's easy to pull off, then I will take it off. But it's a little bit, if it's a little bit difficult to pull off, I'll probably leave it until it's easier to pull off. All right, the next one is tissue culture tetrasperma or regular tetrasperma. This one kind of strikes a chord with me. Not only because I cannot pronounce the first word in that name, Raphidophora tetrasperma. But also because I think that this has been such a heavily debated topic in the year of 2019. I think that the tetrasperma is like the plant of 2019. I have so much to say about this. I might ruffle some feathers here. But I do want to say that I personally have a tissue culture tetrasperma and I feel just as satisfied with that as I would if I had a true tetrasperma. And after a lot of research and talking to people and sellers, I have found that the tissue culture tetrasperma, it does look different in its juvenile form, which if you have a tissue culture one, you probably have it in its juvenile form, but as it gets older, it will look like the original plant that it was cloned from. And tissue culture is just cloning of a plant. So if you want to know more information about that, there's so many things on the internet about it by now, I'm sure, but a tissue culture Raphidophora tetrasperma is just a clone. So it does take on a few different characteristics, but I think that, do I want to say this? I think a lot of the time people can say, or I've seen people saying that the tissue culture is ugly in comparison to the true form and that it's not as good. And I think that that is just a little bit elitist. I'm just gonna say it. I'm sorry. I already feel bad for saying it. I think that the tissue culture tetrasperma is priced a lot lower and it's a lot more accessible, and I think that plants not being accessible to a big portion of people is an issue because they're so expensive and people, like the average person who has a job, who has kids, who has a mortgage, who has all of these things, student loan debt, like I know that firsthand. A lot of people cannot afford to spend $90 on a plant willy-nilly when people get all elitist because they have the original tetrasperma and talk down to the tissue culture. It really makes me mad because it's like buying the store brand versus the name brand. Like, it's the same thing. It just doesn't make any sense to me why people get so upset about it. If it is being advertised as a true tetrasperma and they don't say it's a tissue culture, I can see why people would be upset. But I am so happy that I got two tissue culture tetraspermas for less than I would have paid for one single tiny true tetrasperma. So that is just my opinion on that. There's a lot of elitist things that happen in the plant community that I don't agree with. Pest control. Natural remedies such as beneficial nematodes or chemicals. Shout out to Nicole, that was her question. And I would say that natural remedies would probably be my choice. There's a lot of natural remedies out there that work really, really well. I will say though that if I had a full-on greenhouse thing, like I was selling plants by the hundreds, I would probably turn to chemicals, to be honest with you. I don't know, maybe I might change my mind later about that. I have had conversations in the past with people who own nurseries and grow plants, and they've told me that the natural remedies just don't work on some bugs. And when you get something in your greenhouse, you need to eliminate it as fast as you possibly can. And sometimes these bugs have overcome the natural remedies and they have found a way to, I don't know, through evolution or something, but they have found a way to survive neem oil and insecticidal soap and all of these things that we use. And they even have found a way to overcome certain chemicals that are used, like certain pesticides. I don't know, that's really difficult. But in my home, of course, I would choose natural remedies because this is where I live. And if my dog licks the plant, or God forbid he eats something, or like if I have kids someday, I definitely, well, not if, but when I have kids someday, I would definitely want to have natural things just in case they eat it or something happens. If you own a greenhouse or you know someone who does, I would love to know what you think about this. All right, so the next one is pro auction or against auction. And I think this is like selling a plant via auction. This one is hard because I know a lot of people sell their plants via auction, and I have an opinion, but I also don't judge people who do the opposite, so just know that. But I don't think that I would ever sell a plant via auction, just because I think it's kind of awkward, because there's been several times where I've put in for an auction and it's like awkward because they're like, oh, someone bid against you, like what are you gonna put? And I'm like, oh, I don't know, like it's stressful for the buyer, for the seller, I'm sure. And so it's just a lot to keep up with. I'd rather slap a price on it and see what happens. Sometimes I think that people, and again, not everybody, but I think that sometimes people can kind of take advantage of plant people and like the amount of money that they'll spend. So they're like, here's this wet stick Monstera alba with no leaves, one node, how much are you willing to pay? And like people will put so much money into it, and it's just like, yikes. I don't know. Personally, I don't think I would ever auction a plant. I would just put a price on it and sell it. That's a lot easier for me. All right, the next one is tap water versus distilled water. I would say both, because certain plants actually do need distilled water or rainwater. And I hate admitting that, because early on in my plant journey, I was like, I will never, ever give my plants distilled water. And here I am buying distilled water for my plants. I will say though that there's only like maybe 5 or 6 plants that get distilled water, so I don't go through that much of it. And the reason that I do it is because the water where I live is very, very tough and hard, so it would definitely hurt my plants, and I don't need extra brown spots or brown tips on my plants, because with those plants specifically, like I'm talking like Anthurium and Calathea, I want them to stay as beautiful as possible. And just knowing that the fluoride and minerals in my water can burn the leaves, I just don't want to mess with that. However, with my common plants, like every other plant besides Calathea and Orbifolia, that's the same thing. All my other plants besides Calathea and Anthurium get regular water. All my philodendrons, all my monsteras, and they're totally happy. So it just depends, I think, on the plant. And which is funny for me saying this, because like I said, I was not a big fan of this in the past. Okay, the next one is moisture meter or finger. That's so funny. Okay, for a long time, I was finger only. But more recently, I have been using my moisture meter a lot more. And I think that is because I have a lot of bigger plants. And I started using it a lot more when I got my fiddly fig, to be honest with you, because yeah, I was just really nervous that I would overwater or underwater it. And so when you have a big like 12-inch pot, it's really hard to get your finger all the way down in there when my finger is like 4 inches long, you know? So I'm not getting down into the bottom of the pot. So for my bigger plants, I definitely use my moisture meter. But for smaller plants, I really just kind of pick up the plant and see how heavy it is. That is how I tell if a plant needs water most of the time. And I feel like when I heard that, when I was much younger in my plant journey, I was like, this person is crazy, but it's actually true. Like, there will come a point where you will know if your plant needs water based on how heavy the pot is. Okay, the next one is leaf shine or a natural solution. I was very tempted to buy leaf shine the other day because it makes your leaves look immaculate, like actually very shiny. But the thing is, it's just another thing to buy when I could just make something at home with things that I already have. So I prefer the natural remedies just because it's easier. It's not like difficult to whip up some lemon and water and then have a microfiber cloth. So I would prefer that just because it's easier for me. There's a lot of different solutions to cleaning your leaves. One of them is also mixing milk and water. I've done that before, but the smell was just excruciating. I cannot stand the smell of milk. I love the taste of milk, but I cannot smell it. So I usually prefer lemon and water, like half and half, and that's a really great solution. It really cuts through those hard water marks. Okay, the next one is planting right away or waiting for the plant to acclimate. Really out of pure laziness and a little bit of concern for the plant, I usually wait for the plant to acclimate. And I do that by putting it in water or just putting it in a neutral place in my house, which is usually like the kitchen counter or something like that, because it gets ambient light throughout the day, but it's not super intense right there. Yeah, that's what I would say for that one. And I think it is important to let your plants acclimate, of course. If the plant is clearly not doing well, probably a good move to repot it, but usually I do let it acclimate just so it's not too much stress all at one time. Okay, the next one is buying rare plants for a lot of money or waiting for the price to drop. Okay, this is hard because I've been on both sides of the coin before. I have purchased a plant that was like really cool at the time for a high price, and I've also waited for a good deal. Having waited for the good deal, I would say that I would prefer that moving forward just because it feels more satisfying, especially if you can find that plant in person. And usually the price is a lot lower if you just wait a few months, maybe a year. I know that that's not the greatest thing to have to wait. Yeah, I waited for my Tetrasperma for a while. I was very tempted to buy it online a couple of times, but I just waited. And then I found a tissue culture in person at a farmer's market, and it was perfect. I think that it's not a bad thing to buy the plant when it's super in style, but you can't do that with every single plant. All right, guys, that would be all for this video. Thank you so much for sending in your questions for me to put in my opinion. I had a lot of fun filming this. It was interesting. If you like to see stuff like this or you want more stuff like this, I'm very open to suggestions on videos like this, so leave them in the comments down below. And I will see you guys in my next video. Bye!